Hi and welcome to session 9 of the Internet Video 101 training. I can't believe that we've already got 8 weeks behind us. We've got this week and next week, and that's it, you're a video producer. So tonight we're going to look specifically at video production. So we're going to have a final look at the video creation process. We're then going to talk about the different video editing software that you can work with. And then look at the actual process in a little bit more detail, how we actually build things together. And really what we're talking about today is how we take the footage that we recorded last week and how we turn that into a really, really polished, finished video that we can then use to drive traffic or to get sales or to promote our products. So our final refresher on the video creation process. We write our script, and you remember when you're writing the script, you're using all of the worksheets, using the features and benefits, and you're writing a script around the AIDA process. We take that script, and from it, we create a PowerPoint. And in the PowerPoint, we're using lots of images to really pull people's emotions out. We then sit down and record our voiceover. Once we've recorded it, we polish it all up, we get it all nice. Then we take that and we capture our slides and we use the voiceover in the background as sort of a reference to enable us to synchronize things. Then we get on to producing the video. So obviously we've done the first 4 steps over the previous 4 weeks. Tonight we're going to actually produce that video. So we looked last week at some different tools that you can use for capturing video, and the one that we worked with was Camtasia, which is a little bit more advanced than some of the others. And one of the things that's pretty good with it is it comes with Camtasia Studio, which allows you to do a certain amount of editing. However, for what we want to do now, it can still be a little bit restrictive. So we're going to look at really taking our videos to the next level. And we're going to start looking at specific, specialized video editing software. So what do I mean when I talk about video editing software? Well, there's a few key things. It provides us with a timeline. Okay? So we can see in clips, right from the beginning of our movie all the way to the end, more or less what's going on. We can see the structure of it. We can move around on that timeline and see what's happening at any particular moment in time. It gives us multiple layers, so we can build things on top of each other. So we can put a video track down, then we can put some titles on top of that, then we can maybe put some more graphics on top of that if we want to. One of the things we're going to look at today is we're going to put a track down there, and we're effectively going to cut a hole in that track and put another track behind it so that it looks through like it's looking through a window. It gives us some effects. Now, here I'm talking about not just video effects, but also audio effects. So we can do things with our audio to make the voiceover really punch through, but to keep a good volume with any music that's in the background. I think there's nothing worse in a sales video of having some music there that's so sort of weak and quiet that it might as well not be there because it just distracts. But there's certain effects that we can use that will allow us to bring the level of the music quite loud in conjunction with the audio, but with the audio still cutting through, the voiceover rather, cutting through really nice and loud so that we can hear clearly what's being said. We can also look at video effects. For example, how we transition from one screen to another if we're doing mixed live and PowerPoint videos. We can look at maybe doing some coloration effects. We can use effects, for example, just having some titles animating in, zooming, that type of thing. So these are all just effects. And the most important thing for us, it allows us to output our videos. Okay, is what we term rendering the video. So it allows us to render it into various different formats. And if you remember from early on in the course, we talked about all the different formats that are available. And what I prefer to do is when I've finished my video is to actually render to a .mov format. And one of the reasons that I like to do that is because what we're going to look at next week is we're going to take QuickTime Pro, I'm going to take these MOV files, and QuickTime loves MOV files. It's the native file format for QuickTime. We're going to use that to produce some very high quality MP4s in preparation for us uploading to the internet. So I'm going to look at sort of two levels of software. There's the budget software options first, and then we'll look at some high-end software as an alternative. There's four main packages that I would encourage you to look at. The first one is, if you're on a PC, Sony Vegas Movie Studio. I used that for about 6 months when I started doing a lot more intense video marketing. It's a great package. It's very reliable. It's not huge. Some of these products tend to be very big when you install them, and this one wasn't. It's one of these products that allows a 30-day trial, so you can download it and get started straight away. And it's fairly easy to find your way around with it. There's also Pinnacle Studio. Pinnacle Studio is made by a company called Avid, and Avid are well known in the broadcast arena. They make something called Avid Media Composer, which a lot of Hollywood producers will actually work with. So Pinnacle Studio is really their home version of their Hollywood production software. And incidentally, I used Pinnacle Studio prior to moving to Sony Vegas. There's also Adobe Premiere Elements. Now, this is an interesting one because I use the professional version of Adobe Premiere, not the Elements version, and I would be hard-pressed to consider moving to anything else. However, the general feeling in the marketplace is that the Adobe Premiere Elements product is not in the same league in terms of quality as the professional software. So whilst it is an option, it's similarly priced to the others. Personally, I would go with Sony Vegas Movie Studio. Now, Adobe Premiere Elements, again, has a trial. It's worth downloading, having a look at if it's something that might interest you. Finally, if you're on a Mac, you've got iMovie available. We talked about that a few weeks ago when we looked at Windows Live Movie Maker. iMovie is sort of halfway between Windows Live Movie Maker and some the rest of these products here. The great thing is, if you've got a Mac, you've probably already got iMovie on it. Now, if we look at the higher-end software, and I'm still not talking thousands here, I'm talking hundreds of dollars, really. There are three main products on the market. Sony Vegas Pro is the, obviously it's the professional version of Sony Vegas Movie Studio that I mentioned previously. It was actually the first high-end software package that I got to work with, and I got to work with this a few years ago. This was before I had any form of screen capture. All I had available to me was Sony Vegas Pro, a professional editing package for the sound, and a large collection of images. And I literally made my images by animating everything by hand in Sony Vegas Pro, and it took me days. But it did allow me to really understand just how flexible Sony Vegas can be. So that is a good option to consider. There is Adobe Premiere Pro, which I use, and I'll come back in a moment to why I use this one. If you're on a Mac, there's also Final Cut Pro. There's a little bit of controversy at the moment about that. The latest version, some people are saying you're better off moving to Adobe Premiere, but I'm sure that'll sort itself out. Adobe Premiere Pro is available on Mac or PC. So tonight we will be using Adobe Premiere Pro, and that's what I'll be going through, and that's what I'll be demonstrating. But one thing to bear in mind is it doesn't actually matter what software you use for what we're doing tonight. Some of the exact functions might be slightly different, some of the menus will be slightly different, but the fundamental techniques of what we're trying to do is the same in all of these packages. So I did promise you I would come back and just mention why I chose Adobe Premiere Pro. And it was a couple of things. One of the things that I like to do with video is to embed one video inside another. And if you remember when we did the PowerPoint last week, One of the slides actually had a screen on there with a green background. And we're going to use that too. We're going to cut that background out and put a video behind it. But I've also done some live footage where I've been sitting in front of my computer monitors. And I've had those monitors, and I've actually inserted live video over the top of those monitors, so it looked like it was actually playing there. And I did that with Sony Vegas Movie Studio, and it took me hours. It really did, because you're scaling and compressing and moving, and it doesn't seem to really work as you expect it to, so there's lots of trial and error. Whereas I learned that in Adobe Premiere Pro, there's an effect called corner pin, where you put the video on the timeline, you add this effect to it, and you literally click on the corners and drag them where you want them. And that so far has probably saved me at least a week of work. Also, I wanted to do a lot of motion graphics. So you probably noticed at the beginning of each of the Internet Video 101 training videos, there's a very short clip that plays that introduces the video. And that's done in a product called After Effects. It's another Adobe product. I also use Photoshop for all of my graphics production, all of my photo editing as well. And Adobe do some very nice suites. So I got what's called their Production Premium Suite. And that was Photoshop, Premiere Pro, After Effects, and a whole bunch of other things that I probably don't use on a day-to-day basis, but are available to me. So Premiere Pro it is. So tonight, we're going to be looking at the video editing process. As I say on here, it's really bringing the magic to life. You're probably already really impressed with the videos that you made last week, and so you should be. We've only been studying this for a few weeks, and already you've created a video, you've created a PowerPoint, you've recorded it, you've got some footage there that you can be proud of. But what we're going to do now is we're going to take it from that point, which a lot of people can do, and we're going to really bring it to life. So let's have a look at the actual process of editing the video. And I will demonstrate this to you in a few minutes, but just so you understand the process. We're going to import assets. Now, the assets that I'm referring to is any AVI files that you created from Camtasia, any graphics that you might need to overlay in there, any music that you want to overlay. It will be the WAV file that you created from your voiceover. Okay, all of these things we'll import into our video editing software. Once we've imported it, we can start using it. We can drop it down on the timeline and move it around. So we're then going to take the PowerPoint footage that we've got as an AVI file, we've imported it as an asset, and we're going to drag it down and put it on the timeline. We may need to trim it a little bit. If you remember, we had the long gap at the beginning and the end in order to give us something to work with. But we're going to drop that down onto the timeline, and we're going to start editing from there. What we then do is we take the voiceover track and we synchronize it. Now, a lot of people think this is an unnecessary step, and I've tried shortcutting this, but if you can remember back to the old cassette recorder days, some of you might be too young to remember that, but I remember we used to do tape-to-tape recording. So we'd play one tape and we'd record it onto another one. And every time you do that, you lose a little bit of quality. And theoretically, it's different with digital. But in practice, I've found that doing it this way, taking the voiceover track and adding it in separately and synchronizing it, guarantees that we maintain quality. Whereas doing anything else doesn't guarantee that. Particularly if you had to resort to the trick of putting the microphone in front of the speaker, which we talked about last week with Camtasia. If you had to do that, you will definitely have a poor quality audio. And even so, the defaults on Camtasia always record at a much lower quality level than you will have produced from your voiceover file. So we're going to add the voiceover track and we're going to synchronize it. I'll show you how to do that. We're then going to add some background music in there. And depending on what sort of video you're doing, you might have some nice, quiet, peaceful music in the background. You might have some real up-tempo music in the background, maybe quite loud. So what you need to do is you need to consider how those levels are all going to fit together, potentially turn it up, turn it down, and use some tricks so that everything comes, so that it's supporting the voiceover, but the voiceover can still be heard clearly. And once we've done that, we'll render the video. And as I mentioned a few minutes ago, we'll render it out as a .mov file. And that's what we're going to be using next week to produce our video for distribution. So there's only a few steps to it. It is actually a very simple process. A lot of people get hung up because it looks more complicated when we get into the software. But I assure you, the best way to convince yourself that it's a simple process is to go and make a few videos. I found it very complicated the first time I saw it, but by the time I was making my third video, I was already into my stride and doing it quite naturally.